Hey, my name's Christina, and welcome back to my blog. Today I'm going to be talking about a lab aspect of my life, which is funding. And I wanted to share personally why I'm motivated to talk about funding. So one thing is I grew up in a family of three that made less money than I do now as a single adult. We made about 20K, and now as a graduate student, I made about 30K. So I really know how to, you know, clip coupons, be frugal, and a lot of my spending. So it's translated to me being able to support more than just myself when emergencies come up, and then also, you know, being able to save for retirement and not get put behind what my colleagues in the job market directly are in terms of savings, even though it's not perfect. Tea is brewed. I'm going to pour it into these reused kombucha bottles I have. And originally, when I made this blog to talk about funding, which, to clarify, I think you should look at as you study schools and then ask about as you're going through the process, because transparency is key, and it's going to take up a lot of your time if you have to self-fund. Versus if someone's supporting you and finding your funding options. And it will, for me, let me have a lot more say over my research project, which I was super pumped about. So I thought I was going to cover teaching internal grants and external grants in this blog, but there just wasn't time. So what I'm going to do instead is I'm going to talk mainly about the external grant writing process, which for me was NSF. There's also ones from departments of defense and other funding sources. Ford, some different companies have different opportunities for external grants. But then in the next vlog, I want to cover teaching and looking at a teaching contract and what those responsibilities on top of study may look like. And then I won't touch on, but I encourage everyone to research internal funding at their university. So I received a merit and identity-based scholarship when I first came to Michigan, and that helped me fund my first year before moving on to teach my second year, and then be funded through NSF for the remaining time in my program. So a big part of the grad school experience, applying to funding, even presenting at conference, is reading through the literature. So I have a lot of papers to read tonight. I'm going to head to the library to work on reading through 2 to 3, one being a review and 2 being a specific subset. But before I go to the library, I'm going to make myself some matcha pancakes and some tea. This is the first stop on my study excursion of reading. So I've been going through this review paper. It has some really nice figures, but also a lot of text to go through. And I think this spot, this little hideaway, is pretty awesome. I actually had to wait a while to film reading here because a lot of other people were in and out. So this is just a quick look at some of the rest of the room. I think this is my favorite piece, having touched on calligraphy in the past. You can just see this board is nice to try things out. It feels a lot less permanent than using up my inks and paper. I have done different things here. I did character calligraphy back in the day, so sometimes the more complicated characters, practicing circles on this board has been a help to me. So this is specifically hiragana. It runs, it's not perfect, but it is a really low stress. If you're worried about perfectionism, it fades away. So I have that, which is probably my favorite spot of the room. Then the massage chairs, as I mentioned, and a light therapy. We are on the move again.
So we are moving spots. I finished the review paper. It was a lot to take in. I definitely need to look up some of their references to get more specific details, but I want to move to the cafe. I probably won't get a drink. I still have some of the tea I brewed, but I'm almost out of pancake. So I think once we get to the cafe, I'll go into a bit more detail about how I first learned of NSF, how it was different than I perceived, and then how to frame decisions in the best possible light. So I stepped to the side. I'm actually in front of where the Mujo Cafe employees have lockers, just to not disturb the people who are studying. And I wanted to get back to the topic of NSF. So when I was in high school, I thought these grants, it was a small rural school. My dad had no exposure to the industry, and I was, you know, just being raised by him with an older brother who would go on to become a welder and go through a more community college approach. So I would say my idea of the academy was a little bit naive. I thought they were these perfect humans who read everything, who knew so many facts before you even explain them, and always check that you had the right references, that your calculations were perfect, and they would find, you know, through peer review, the absolute best people. And they try. They try really hard, and I'm not saying they don't do those things, but the thing I didn't realize until I got to Princeton, and I talked to people who are actually invited to review NSF applications, is they're imperfect humans. It might be that you have a professor that just got off a red-eye flight from California to Washington, D.C. for the review session. He now has 20 proposals that he has skimmed, but he hasn't finished writing up his summary of in front of him. And he wants to sleep tonight. So the easier you make their job of telling what your intellectual merit is and what your broader impact is, which is the two criteria they'll use to judge your application, the better it's going to be for everyone. He's going to have an easy time following. And you don't assume he knows everything. He's read some of the literature, but there's just way too much out there for someone to be an expert on every little niche. And so you want to define your terms. You want to make sure it's really clear what assumptions you are applying to your system, where it will have real-world application. And so you have to spell it out. And it's not dumbing it down. You want to talk like you're speaking to an academic, someone who reads intellectual, you know, reporting for a living, but don't assume they know what you're talking about just because you've read 50 papers that use the same jargon or that made the same assumptions. To highlight a couple unique things about this grant, basically you can apply twice. Once before you enter a graduate program and once after you enter a graduate program, either your first or second year. So when I applied at Princeton, my senior year, I was able to have people help me proofread it. I was able to get a lot of interactions and learn really the science part. I think based on the comments I got back, they really liked my intellectual merit, but my broader impact wasn't as clear. And I think that's something I learned at Michigan, was just a little bit more about how to frame broader impact, but also life experience of things that added to me as a character. So I actually came here my first year. I wasn't sure if I was going to do grad school. I had written the thing, but I'm like, I want to support my family. I want to be engaged at home. Do I go and take a industry position? And I decided I really wanted to pursue research because of the curiosity I have and how I think, you know, it'll just lead to a better quality of life for me because I am excited about my work. Not every day, but most days. And when I got here the first year, it wasn't really easy to find a project. The project didn't start up. You know, I didn't come early. I realized some of the people, you know, came directly after graduating. I came in August. For many reasons, whether it be a difficult relationship with collaborators that, you know, was sorted out but took time, I did not feel ready to apply. And I think, well, in hindsight, I know it worked, but a lot of people put pressure
to apply the first year when you're young, when you, you know, don't have as much judgment coming from your first year as a career. Because I was told if I don't publish in between my first and second year, I will probably not even be considered as a second year. And this wasn't entirely the case. I would have a second author paper out from an internship, but I would not have a first author paper, and I would have no paper from the year of graduate school. But just because I had intended to switch into biodiagnostics and then came back to more polymer physics, it didn't mean I had to, you know, explain the messy interpersonal details of why things evolved. I can explain the takeaways. So why did I spend a year there? What's the greatest takeaway of me being in a biodiagnostic group? It's working with clinicians. It's being able to collaborate better with medical practitioners, knowing their language, knowing their standards of proof, just knowing more of their norms. And so that's what I wrote why I waited a year. I wanted to do this rotation to establish norms. And I hadn't seen that going in, but by the time I left, that is what I took away from it. And then I moved back into polymer physics, back into what I have experience with. Yes, I've diverted, I haven't made progress, but I've added additional skills. The help was over the summer. We did have preliminary data. I picked up a partially started project, and then I twisted it or expanded it into my own. So it was this absorption model that was a novel algorithm, and I took it into the hemorheology or blood flow space, applying it at the time to stent absorption. And it was creating this narrative, which was a lot of reaction and me trying to be in the right place at the right time, but not knowing how it would end up. And when I tell it back to somebody, instead of saying, you know, it was random chance, it was me taking the available opportunities I was given. And it was purposeful. Okay, so I read the next paper. It was mainly experimental, and it had a gel point model I have heard of. I think it's chapter 5 of one of the textbooks my professors wrote, and I want to go and read that next. Because it was experimental and it referenced this model I don't have as much prior knowledge about without explaining it, I'm going to go back and reference that book and then reread the paper. And I wanted to check in a final time to just cover maybe some of the stray topics on NSF, and also throughout just these miscellaneous topics, I want to show you different views of the library, which is a 24-hour library, and there were students there pretty much until I got ready to leave campus. And so I won't be talking with you in the library, but giving you a short tour. So I think some of the last things to explain is you apply to a subject area. So in undergrad, I applied just to mechanical engineering, but once I got here and it was really clear the interdisciplinary nature of my work, I applied to polymer engineering, and I think that helped get my paper in the right reader's hands. So that was something to consider. Also just like the availability of other readers, whether it be your graduate student friends or someone who's been through the review process themselves and been a judge of it. It depends on your resources, but yeah, definitely have other eyes on it. Some more hints on broader impact is also teaching. I really emphasize my outreach and working with high schoolers and elementary schoolers in STEM. And then the idea of having an undergrad assist on the project and having mentorship through that as well. So I think incorporating a teaching mindset can be really helpful to your application. And then, let's see, I think, yeah, I want you to
know that you belong here. Like, regardless of your background, you can succeed as a grad student, so don't sell yourself short. It can be really uncomfortable to write something that brags about your diversity, brags about your achievements, but you do belong here. You did have unique experience. You know, you're studying an important problem, so go into the application with confidence. This is the computer and video game library, which I think might be here in part because we have such a strong music program and the making of video game music, but it's also a really cool place to hang out. It has some wonky hours, mainly during work hours, but this was the only place that didn't have people, and just having a collaborative space, there are people.